are you doing?
Nothing. I'm done with all my work. I have nothing else to do.
Why don't you try reading that book?
No, thank you. I don't like reading.
Oh, no, 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 no. Why don't you try reading this book? Give it a shot. Let me know how it goes.
Okay, I will.
Leave the lights on. Leave the lights on.
Can you leave the lights on?
Hey, how was it? Did you like it?
No.
Aww.
I loved it. Thank you so much for your help. Whenever I have time, I will start to read daily. Thank you.
Glad you liked the book. Good morning, everyone. My name is Monica Nutini, and welcome to my senior talk. How many of you love to read? If you do, please turn to your partner and give them a thumbs up. Thumbs down if you don't like it, and in the middle if not so much. Hey, I saw your thumbs down, put it up. Well, I love to read. I'm all about that thumbs up. Reading is something I really enjoy doing. I just love how I can dive into the author's world and learn from their perspective, which is why I decided to volunteer at my old elementary school, Walter J. Porter, to help kids develop their reading and writing skills. If you don't like to read, yes, you, and you. Yes, you too, Mom. It's okay, you are not alone. I am here to tell you how passionate I am about showing kids the power of reading and how crucial it is for their education. I don't know if you, but many adults have dropped out of college because of their inability to read high-level text. I want to help the kids before it's too late. Some even struggle with reading and are not getting the help they need and the right tools. I want to help the kids before it's too late. As many of you know, in high school and in college, the amount of rigor in writing increases. How can students write if they don't read daily? How can students become successful in the future without the basic fundamentals of learning, like math, English, science, and etc.? Well, here's the answer to that question. What you read, study, learn in school helps you gain knowledge, and knowledge is power. I believe everyone is smart. We not only read books, but also have the ability to read and learn things online, which is a great way for a toddler to learn. But the first priority for them is reading. While volunteering at Walter J. Porter, I gave a survey for the children to complete, and this is the result. 56% of the students speak English, 25% speak Spanish, and 19% speak two or more other languages. If a student is barely learning English because it is their second language, just know that it takes time for them to master English. It takes time, reading, and practice. 63% of their siblings read at home. 37% do not. This 30% is a wake-up call for me. It shows me that there are students not only reading at school, but they are not reading at home as well. Please, take a look at this graph. Students in Walter J. Porter are reading only 3 times a week. 3 times is not enough for a child to do well in reading and literature. But something shocked me as I learned more about these wonderful students, that 25% do not enjoy reading. That means 25% of these students will struggle in school and may even be a dropout because reading be- becomes increasingly difficult as they move up to high school. Crazy, right? No? So I went home and I did more research about the kids' reading level and found out that only that 30% of children entering kindergarten lacks basic language level needed to learn how to read. 65% of fourth graders read at below basic level. Do you guys see the problem now? This is a major problem. These numbers are huge, really huge. You don't even know. The kids' interest in reading is important to me. Why? Because they are the next generation to make America's future better, as Whitney Houston would say. I believe the children's our future. I am doing something about the lack of interest in reading. Now I would like to show you a video about illiteracy in the world. Enjoy.
So the world today is facing huge problems we've never faced before in the course of human history.
We are at a crucial intersection. When we look at it, the problems are rather large.
From our environment and how we deal with water and energy, the ability to better communicate and share our ideas with others.
And the solutions are only going to come over the course of generations and not only over the course of the work of many people.
It's the power of 7 million human beings and what can they do together to think and implement on certain solutions.
There are almost 800 million people that are illiterate in the world today. It's been estimated that if we could bring roughly 170 million of them into literacy, that we could remove close to 12% of the world's poverty.
Now, that's an enormous number of people who now have a stability in their lives that they didn't have before.
When we think about the impact on a whole nation's ability to have productive citizens, to advance quality of life, to have better health outcomes, education is truly fundamental. But the question is, how do you reach that?
We need to change the paradigm of learning itself, that perhaps the model of learning of bringing kids to a classroom and somebody lecturing them on something is perhaps getting outdated.
This experiment allows us to examine in a very detailed way what are the pros of technology, what are the advantages of using technology for learning.
Ethiopia has one of the highest illiteracy rates in the world. The village of Wanchi is no exception. Nobody there can read or write. That's why I was astonished when they dropped 20 Motorola tablets, preloaded with mostly literacy apps, in the village with no instructions. Within a few days, they were learning to write letters. And within a month, they were learning to speak them too. It's a sign of great hope for the 100 million children around the world who will never go to school.
Kids today are learning better in interactive environments. They are learning better if they're simply catalyzed to do certain kinds of reflection.
If you can learn to read on your own and then read to learn, you can have access to that world of information and opportunity that's unprecedented.
So it gives us a chance to see, you know, what is child-driven learning in a detailed way. If they can read at a second grade level, I wonder, you know, what about their writing skills? Can they use the same platform for learning mathematics and art,
ethics, for a whole variety of things? All of a sudden becomes a global learning platform for which kids in local communities are collaborating together to learn and then sharing and connecting with each other worldwide to learn.
So now the deeper question is, how is it that individuals interact with one another and learn from one another and contribute to each other's life as individuals? This is what this platform has the potential to show.
We know from the tests that we've done that this approach works.
We think we can get the cost down so low that deploying these tablets is dramatically less expensive than, you know, training hundreds, if not thousands, of teachers, building schools, building buildings. But it also is very, very quickly deployed. It doesn't take an entire generation. It takes a few days to get that tablet out to the children.
The content that you're going to provide is going to allow each individual to harness the uniqueness of who they are, to become good leaders for their community, for their society, for their nation.
So when we talk about a literacy moksha, it's really saying that these forces are completely aligned at this moment in time. You have to go for it because it's achievable. If we really bring together the right people, the right resources, we can do it.
As the video stated, there is 800 million people who are currently illiterate in the world. This is a major problem. These 800 million people have the power to change the world because they are special. Everyone's special in their own way. These 800 million people was probably struggling with reading because they didn't have the right tools, guidance, and support they needed. But with this generation, we all have ways to access books. Consider us lucky. So you may ask, Monica, how did you get the children to read? Well, I brought books for them to read. I walked and talked with them, and I made bracelets with them every Monday. Honestly, I just made fun reading as fun as possible for them. Monday after Monday, I started to enjoy my time with them even more. It was like we were all diving into this awful world together. Try it, but be aware. Yes, be aware. There is that one kid who is always going to not share the same perspective as you about reading. Don't like reading as much as you do. So, this is the part where you try very hard to persuade them that reading is important and that they really need it. I remember when I had to inform someone that reading was very important. That someone was my cousin. She was someone who wasn't a fan of reading, always told me that reading was boring. Until I encouraged her to come with me to the library to check out some books. I recommended her a book called Maze Runner by James Dashner. And ever since that day, she couldn't stop reading and stop talking about it. And I was happy that I had opened up her mind and heart to books. If you have someone in your family or know anyone that's struggling with reading, please take your time with them. Help them how to read. Help them open up their imagination. It'll be worth your time, I promise, because you're not only helping them, but you are saving them by giving them a good start of education. Tutoring kids has taught me that kids are not reading as much as often because they're not being encouraged to read. What better way to improve a child's reading rather than practicing their grammar and vocabulary? Reading is very important. Once they become good readers, they can overcome any reading and writing obstacles. Today, a reader. Tomorrow, a leader. Did you know that if a student stops reading for a whole summer, they forget months worth of progress? Crazy, right? Is it? Yeah, it is. Reading is really fun. It really is. For example, when you read, do you notice yourself asking questions like, who is the character? Where is the character from? What is the main point of this book? And why did this plot happen? These are all signs that you have gotten deep into the book. Now I would like to show you another video of what I did with the kids on my senior experience. Enjoy. Yeah. kids who are not being read to enter school being less prepared. 260,000 dollars is spent on kids who repeat a grade because of poor reading. Each dropout over his or her lifetime costs the nation approximately $260,000 a year. $2 billion is spent on kids who repeat a grade level because of poor reading. In 1998, 10 million students between the age of 7 and 11 performed a below basic level in reading in California. In 2004, 47% of kids who took the ACT did not meet the ACT's requirement. If a child reads as much as 1 million words per year, they will be in the top 2% of all children on the standardized test. That means 3,000 words a day will get the children to where they need to be. Now I would like to ask the audience an example of an ACT question. Question number one. The threat of rain didn't blink. Her stroll through the grounds. Even the first drops were no blade, and she continued her walk. Is it A, hinder and incentive, B, thwart, refuge, C, impede and deterrent, D, permit, provocation, and E, prevent and enticement? Does anyone know that? Can that happen? Elizabeth, what is it? D? D as in dog? The answer to number one is C, impede and deterrent. We can tell by the second sentence that the woman went on a walk through the rain, so D isn't the correct answer. Even the first word of the second sentence implies that the raindrops should have done something, but did not. The rain should have been deterrent, but it was not. Question number two. The student who had a flu, Blake, reason for missing school. They normally have perfect attendance, and their absence that day was a blank. Is it A, unjustifiable and travesty, B, legitimate and aberration, C, unwarranted and anomaly, D, sensible, farce, or E, inconsolable and fluke? It's what? D?
D?
C as in dog? I mean, C as in cat? No? The answer to number two is B. Legitimate and aberration. The students were sick, which indicated that they had a good reason for missing school. That leaves only B and D. Because students are normally in attendance, their absence is unlikely to be farce, foolish, or humorous. Therefore, their absence was an aberration, or departure from the normal. I would like for all of us to help young people become strong readers so that we can help more successful boys and girls in school. We all know that staying in school is directly correlated with having more successful jobs. So, if a student is in school learning, they will become more successful. They will become successful contributors to society. Thank you for being an awesome audience. This concludes my senior talk.